my name is Crystal Ngo, and I manage diversity, equity, and inclusion guidance programs at AnitaB.org, the nonprofit organization that produces the Grace Hopper Celebration. And it is my pleasure to introduce our featured speaker. Joy Buolamwini is a poet of code who uses art and research to illuminate the social implications of artificial intelligence. She founded the Algorithmic Justice League to fight the coded gaze bias in AI. At the MIT Media Lab, she pioneered techniques that are now leading to increased transparency in the area of facial analysis technology globally, and she currently leads the IEEE working group that is creating the first international standards for facial analysis technology. Joy's TED Talk on algorithmic bias has been viewed over 1 million times, and more than 230 articles in over 37 countries have cited her gender shades research, which uncovered large accuracy disparities in commercial AI services. Joy is a Rhodes Scholar, Fulbright Fellow, and Google Anita Borg Scholar. She holds master's degrees from Oxford University and MIT, and a bachelor's from the Georgia Institute of Technology. Joy is currently pursuing a PhD at MIT on participatory artificial intelligence, and was recently selected as one of MIT Tech Review's 35 Under 35 honorees. Please welcome Joy Buolamwini to the stage.
People are still filling in, but I will go ahead and get started. How are you feeling? How's Grace Hopper? Yeah, good? All right. So I am a poet of code with a mission of showing compassion through computation. I use art and science to tell stories that make daughters of diasporas dream and sons of privilege pause. Today, I'm really excited to share with you a spoken word piece that's also an algorithmic audit. So I hope you enjoy. And in this particular video, what I do is I pose Sojourner Truth's 19th century question, "Ain't I a Woman?" posed at the 1851 Women's Rights Convention, to 21st century algorithms. And we see how these systems work on the faces of some of the most iconic women of color. My heart smiles as I bask in their legacies, knowing their lives have altered many destinies. In her eyes, I see my mother's poise. In her face, I glimpse my auntie's grace. In this case of deja vu, a 19th century question comes into view. In a time when Sojourner Truth asked, "Ain't I a woman?" Today we pose this question to new powers, making bets on artificial intelligence, hope towers. The Amazonians peek through windows blocking deep blues as faces increment scars. Old burns, new urns, collecting data chronicling our past, often forgetting to deal with gender, race, and class. Again I ask, ain't I a woman? Face by face, the answers seem uncertain. Young and old, proud icons are dismissed. Can machines ever see my queens as I view them? Can machines ever see our grandmothers as we knew them? Ida B. Wells, data science pioneer, hanging facts, stacking stats on the lynching of humanity, teaching truths hidden in data, each entry and omission, a person worthy of respect. Shirley Chisholm, unbought and embossed, the first Black congresswoman, but not the first to be misunderstood by machines well-versed in data-driven mistakes. Michelle Obama, unabashed and unafraid to wear her crown of history, yet her crown seems a mystery to systems unsure of her hair. A wig, a bouffant, a toupee, maybe not. Are there no words for our braids and our locks? Does relaxed hair and sunny skin make Oprah the first lady? Even for her face, well known, some algorithms fault her, echoing sentiments that strong women are men. We laugh, celebrating the successes of our sisters with Serena smiles. No label is worthy of our beauty. As you can see, we have some work to do. This is a reflection of what I call the coded gaze. Now, how many have heard of the male gaze? The white gaze? The post-colonial gaze? Okay, to this lexicon, we add the coded gaze, which reflects the priorities, preferences, and at times prejudices and blind spots of those who have the power to shape technology. So that's my term for algorithmic bias that can lead to exclusionary experiences and also discriminatory practices. So let me show you the personal experience I had that led me to my research with facial analysis technology.
Hi camera, I've got a face. Can you see my face? No glasses face? You can see her face. What about my face? Well, I've got a mask. Can you see my mask?
Straight up disrespect. So after I had the issue of not having my face detected by one system, I decided to check out a few other systems. So some didn't detect my face, but when my face was detected, I was classified as male. I'm not male. So I was like, okay, what's going on here? Then I read a report from Georgetown Law that showed 1 in 2 adults, that's over 130 million people in the United States, has their face in a face recognition network that can be searched by law enforcement unwarranted using algorithms that haven't been audited for accuracy. So I started to get worried. And these worries were founded. In the UK, where they have done tests on facial analysis systems, in the best case scenario, you have false positive match rates at 91%. So this means over 2,400 innocent people being misclassified as criminal suspects. And in Scotland Yard, you even had a case of 2 innocent women being falsely matched with men. So those examples that I was showing earlier have real-world consequences. And it's not just in law enforcement. In hiring, you're starting to see companies like HireVue use facial analysis technology. In an op-ed I wrote for the New York Times about the dangers of facial analysis technology, I mentioned that in their hiring process, what they say is they can infer nonverbal cues to tell you about problem-solving ability. And how they get this kind of data is they train their models on the current top performers at a particular company. I was like, this could go wrong in so many ways. And I mean, if you're in violation of Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, we're in trouble. But beyond computer vision, AI, and in general, automated decision making is starting to impact many areas of our lives. So whether you get hired or fired, yes, but even who has access to housing, you have college admissions processes that are now starting to use AI when it comes to money. Credit decisions are being made using AI, how much you and I pay for a good when we're shopping online. And then as you saw with the policing examples, the loss of liberty, it also becomes an issue with systems like predictive policing. So this and many more issues are some of what led me to create the Algorithmic Justice League. And the vision is truly to create a world where technology works for all of us, not just some of us.
And so we do this with a bit of a bias busting strategy. The first thing is to highlight bias so people know, one, it exists. The next thing is identifying bias, and this is where our research comes in. But it's great, you can point out problems, you can talk about it, can you help us fix it? And that's another part of what we do in terms of looking at how to integrate best practices during the design, development, deployment of AI systems. So as mentioned in the intro, I think one of the most effective things we've done so far is the TED Talk with over 1 million views. But we also do art exhibitions at museums. We have a 5-year traveling AI exhibition that will be starting in the Barbican, UK, and we debuted at the Museum of Fine Arts Boston, the Coded Gaze video. So it's really important to get the message out, not just in front of technical crowds. We also do quite a bit of disseminating the research that we've done. Even though most people refer more to this Daily Show episode than my actual thesis, but that's okay. And then finally, thinking about mitigating bias, this is where leading the international standards to think through not only the technical specifications around facial analysis technology, but also the social implications. And then serving on the EU Global Tech Panel to advise world leaders and tech executives on the governance of AI so we can reap the benefits and mitigate the harms. So with this particular talk, I want to focus on the face space and what we can learn from that in terms of diversity and inclusion in tech and making more ethical AI. So you've been hearing me talk about facial analysis technology, but what is it actually? In short, facial analysis technology is about finding patterns around a face, and there are different types of tasks you might do. So the first task is detection. Is there a face? So that example where I'm wearing the white mask, facial detection failure. Then another question you might ask is what kind of face? And so for my thesis work, Gender Shades, we focused on gender classification, but you might have age classification, you might also have emotion classification, which is some of what they're doing with the hiring. And then you have another class of task, which is around recognition. So recognition can come in the form of face verification, one-to-one matching. Let me open my phone, let me get my money from my bank account, or it can come in the form of identification, one-to-many matching. So finding a missing person or trying to find a criminal. When that goes wrong, it means people's liberties are at stake. So as I was learning more about facial analysis technology, I started to question some of the basic assumptions in the field. And one of the basic assumptions is that if we perform well on gold standards, we're doing well overall. So I decided to go to the literature. In 2014, there was much rejoicing in the facial analysis space. Why? Facebook released the paper Deep Face, and it improved performance on the task of face verification by almost 20 percentage points using new deep learning techniques. So it was really exciting. However, people weren't questioning the gold standard benchmark at the time, LFW, labeled faces in the wild. But when you do a breakdown, right, this is 78% male, 84% white. So then you start to question, who are we making progress for? And then I started to look at other benchmarks, IJB-A coming from the US government, pretty pale and male, right? 75%, 80%. And then you have a gender classification benchmark. So I'm like, okay, we got some gender parity. Overwhelmingly lighter skin, however. So more things to do. And this matters because with something like machine learning, it's learning from data. So with data-centric technologies, data is destiny. And right now, we're destined to fail the rest of the world that's not pale and male until we have better representation. But the question is, how do we come to a place where we have such skewed data sets? And the truth is, our data sets and our collection methods often reflect existing structural inequalities. So for this particular benchmark with the US government, they chose images of public officials, and generally they were elected officials. If you look at the representation of men and women in
parliaments worldwide, it's about 77%. So the breakdown in the benchmark reflects this. And if you think about the images you would be able to conveniently get if you're scraping images online, think about who's represented. And again, you have much higher, lighter skin representation. So if you're not intentional, you will reproduce structural power imbalances and inequalities. So if inclusion requires intention, how can we curate more data? And this is part of what I was exploring with my gender shades research. I wanted to know if you had a more inclusive benchmark, would the accuracy rates like what we saw with deep face, 97%, be so high? And so in order to do that, because of the existing skews in the benchmarks, I created a new benchmark, PPB, which you can learn more about on gendershades.org. And so this particular benchmark is better balanced when it comes to gender parity and better balanced when it comes to skin type representation. And the question is, how did we achieve that balance? Well, I got a little help. I went to the United Nations website and I got a list of the top 10 countries by their representation of women in parliament. Rwanda led the way at 61%. I spoke to a Rwandan earlier. She tells me in the latest election they're at 64%. So they're still number one. And in that top 10, you also had progressive Nordic countries and other African countries as well. So I decided to focus on African and European countries in order to have a skin type distribution on opposite ends of the classification scale. And then we went through and we labeled the data set by binary gender labels, not because gender is binary, but because those are the labels we get when we are auditing the various tech companies that have defined it as so. We also used another gold standard from dermatology. And so the Fitzpatrick skin type scale is used by dermatologists to rate skin cancer risk and also skin response to UV radiation. When it was first made, it only had four categories. The first three types of white, I didn't know there are so many ways to burn, but I learned a lot doing the research. And then type four was kind of the rest of the world. And then later on in the 80s, it expanded. But I point this out just to say this other gold standard, right, isn't that inclusive. Binary gender classification is a reduction. Nonetheless, we start somewhere. And so, in labeling the data set in this way led, to my knowledge, the first gender and skin type gender classification benchmark. And so, equipped with this new benchmark, I could actually start to see, might there be bias in commercially sold facial analysis products? And in particular, I wanted to know how accurate IBM, Microsoft, Face++, a billion-dollar tech company in China, were at the task of guessing the gender of a face, right? So how would they do on all of the faces we gathered? Well, if you look at the overall performance, it doesn't seem too bad. 88, okay, we got a B, and then we got some A's, Microsoft in the 94%. But when we start to disaggregate, we see some gaps, right? So if we do the comparison between all the female faces and the male faces, we see an 8 to 21% error gap. If we do that kind of analysis by skin type, again, we're in the double digits when it comes to mistakes. And then something we did for this paper that hadn't been done before was to do an intersectional analysis to see how it worked across skin type and gender. For me, this seemed like a question, it seemed quite straightforward, but I was really surprised that in the literature it hadn't been done. And so when we did this intersectional breakdown, we see for one group there is perfect performance, like flawless, flawless performance. I was like, okay, so y'all can get it right. And then for a different group, not so flawless performance. This was the best in class. This is the best case situation. We move over to Face++, and we're seeing different situation. Here we have darker males are actually the best performing. group. And this is really interesting, right? Because if you just said it performs better on lighter faces than darker faces, and it performs better on male faces than female faces, then where do darker males come in? And you're seeing that the performance varies across company, right? So we have to be continuously checking. And then darker females, whoo, I think we failed, 65%, 66. And then IBM, we're seeing similar results. And even between lighter males and lighter females, right, we're seeing there's a notable gap as well. And then we broke it down even more. So earlier, I mentioned that gender had been reduced to a binary, right? So what's your chance of getting it right by just guessing? 50-50. So error rates as high as 47% is close to a flip of a coin for commercially sold products. I paid to get these results. I'm like, come on now. So after I did the study, I thought the companies might want to know. So I sent them the results before we published, after we were accepted. So it was going to come out anyway, and they knew this. I sent them results without telling them which company that they were, but that they might want to pay attention. So our first response was no response from Megvi. But if you go to their website, they guarantee nothing at all. So I mean, I guess they didn't promise anything. If you go to Microsoft's response was quite corporate. We care about this and we're doing better. So I did a spot check. As of July, I'm still being classified as a 50-year-old male. Do I look 50, though? I don't think so. IBM responded the day I sent the letter, email, really. But the day I sent the email, invited me to their headquarters, replicated the results. The engineers told me it was even worse because I added the padding with the aggregation. And then they released a new API the day that I presented the results. And self-reported, these were their improved metrics, right? So here, best performing group, lighter females. And we've gone from, what, 65% to 96% in a pretty short amount of time. So all of this looks like good news. And then The Intercept reported, right, that IBM had been secretly using surveillance footage from NYPD to train their technology to search by skin type. So sounds like perhaps developing technology for racial profiling. So 100% accurate facial analysis technology, right, that does not necessarily lead to justice or fair and transparent use. So oversight is needed. So let's go over a few key lessons learned from the gender shade study. First one, intersectionality matters. No one subgroup, pale males, dark females, pick your group, should be representing all of the world. And also, as we start to disaggregate metrics, right, we have to keep in mind what the intersections are. Because if we'd only looked at the error rates by gender and if we'd only looked by skin type, we wouldn't have seen such large disparities. The next thing is we got a lot of supremely white data. And the problem with that is it gives us a false sense of progress. So it's not even just thinking about, let's say, facial analysis technology. Let's think about precision health. Right, the right medicine to the right person at the right time. Precisely who are we helping and what kind of clinical data do we have? It wasn't until 1993 that women were even mandated to be part of clinical trials, yet alone people of color. So we have a situation where we don't include the undersampled majority, though many papers talk about minority samples. I'm like, wait, we got these tech companies with global aspirations. Who are these minorities you're talking about? Women and people of color. So it's important that we use the right terminology. The next thing we see is that change is a matter of priority. So many people came up to me after my TED Talk and they're like, well, you know you're highly melanated, got that dark skin. Isn't that why you weren't detected? The cameras, laws of physics. The laws of physics did not change between December 22nd when I sent the audit results, and February 23rd, when we saw that tenfold improvement from IBM. What change was people were making it a priority? But again, as we saw with the NYPD, use of the technology, how it's used is extremely important, right? We could have accurate facial analysis technology on lethal autonomous weapons, drones, cameras, guns, facial recognition, not a great story. And so this is part of why we're developing the international standards, which again is not just about the technical performance of these systems, but also how they're used and context limitations in terms of areas it should not be applied to at all. And then finally, who creates technology matters. It's no surprise that as a dark-skinned woman, I was doing this research, because as I was working on my own personal projects, I kept running into issues, and because I had a technical background, I was able to further explore what was going on. So I'll leave you with a video of how one young girl came to start the Algorithmic Justice League.
When I was 9, I sat in front of a portal that gave me a glimpse of a place where passions danced with possibilities. I was mesmerized by Kismet, the first social robot born of the MIT Media Lab. Kismet smiled at me as if by magic, and I knew then I wanted to uncover its mysteries. Eventually, I learned it was STEM, not magic, that made Kismet possible. The magicians were scientists and engineers. They used the language of mathematics to converse with the universe and create technology to enhance our humanity. STEM matters to me because it fuels my mission to show compassion through computation by using technology in service of others. As an undergraduate, I studied computer science and gained the magical knowledge. I developed skills to build the technology I imagined. Working with a nonprofit, I built an electronic data gathering system to help combat neglected tropical diseases. In Zambia, as a Fulbright Fellow, and in the UK as a Rhodes Scholar, I partnered with grassroots organizations to equip youth to create rights apps. I even started a hair care technology company with 3 other women. We use scientific analysis of hair strands to generate personalized product recommendations. From hair to rights, STEM empowers me to touch topics that impact my life. Most of all, STEM enables me to dream, to stargaze. Stargazing enables all of us to look beyond immediate barriers and see ourselves at heights previously unimagined. When I was 9, I wanted to go to the MIT Media Lab. This was not the assumed destination for a Black girl growing up in Oxford, Mississippi. Now, here I am, striving to earn a PhD while leading the Algorithmic Justice League to fight bias in machine learning. I am her, daughter of art and science, fighter for justice, another hidden figure.
Thank you. And now we should be open for questions. So I think the runners are coming. And I see there are some mics over here. All right. So let's go. Let's get you over here, please.
Hi, I wanted to say thank you. This was amazing and awe-inspiring and touching.
Yeah.
As an individual that is helping to raise 2 little beautiful Black boys, how much of your work is going to be involved in also collecting data for facial recognition for children? And how might that differentiate between what you're currently doing for adults?
Yes, so because of child privacy laws, it's actually quite difficult to get data sets of children, so we have not been able to do that kind of analysis. But this is particularly concerning right now because you have schools that are looking to adopt facial analysis technology. So given so much gun violence in the US, this is now something companies are using as a marketing angle. And you also then have systems that are being linked to gang databases as well. So knowing how quickly children's faces change, face morphology, and so forth, and knowing the biases that are already present when we look at adult classification, I would only expect to find disparities that are that much larger. But I did start doing some spot checks on publicly available children's images on darker skin males, and I was seeing that their faces were being graded as being older than they actually were. I started looking at emotion classification for darker males. Again, faces that I thought just looks, you know, normal were being graded as angry, right? And so when you start to have behavioral analysis and some of the biases and assumptions that might come in, I think it's a highly problematic area. So lots of research areas to explore for people who might be thinking about that space. Thank you so much for your question.
Hi. My name is Erica. I started to do a little digging at my last job, big corporation. I know that there are a lot of companies that are doing work around this and for their own products. And a lot of your work has been just uncovering the problem. Something I discovered in my own research was a big reason this is so pervasive is because the companies are using like crowdsourced data sets, and a lot of them are using the same data sets. And so I'm just really curious to hear you speak a little bit to like, if you've given any thought to what companies can be doing to avoid this sort of problem when, you know, it's the bottom dollar, they're gonna use the data sets they have access to rather than building their own,
et cetera. Great question. So one, if we're talking about the bottom dollar, if you are not including the undersampled majority and you have global aspirations, you are losing a market. The other side of this is in that I advise various tech companies about algorithmic bias, there's actually a new market that's been opened up on algorithmic accountability, where you're starting to see AI bias tools that are offered from various companies. To your point about data sets, and the common use of data sets. If you look at facial analysis technology in general, I showed that example of labeled faces in the wild, which for a while was the benchmark. You also have data sets like Celeb A and others that are full of celebrity photos. So then we have to think, okay, if we have all of these systems, VGG faces, another kind of model, or VGG faces too, that are trained on celebrity data sets, who's included and who's not included? And you also have celebrity data sets that skew quite young. We did I don't know if Deb is Agent Deb in the room. She helps us with the Algorithmic Justice League projects from time to time. She did a really cool study with Black Panther cast members, where we took the Black Panther black cast and we ran them through all of these different analyses. No one could get Angela Bassett's age correct. They were like off by 20 years. I mean, she's young, she's timeless in terms of how she looks, but in an image of a 59-year-old woman, right, being classified as 18 to 24. We had Lupita being classified as white. I was just like, I don't know about that one. I don't know what. Face plus plus, they're being used by the Chinese government right now. So anyhow, thanks for your question. I see there are more.
Good afternoon, thank you for your talk. My name is Vanessa Vassell, and I'm a PhD student in public health at FIU in Miami. And so my question is more on the health perspective.
Yes.
How is your technology potentially going to be used with driverless cars. There's a lot of research that shows implicit bias in the yielding behaviors of drivers toward pedestrians of color. And so with driverless cars coming onto the market soon, it makes me a little nervous as a public health practitioner that certain cars might be whizzing through certain neighborhoods and hurting certain pedestrians, as well as the fact that Black children are less likely to have the proper restraints for their age and their weight. And so just a little talk about that, I really appreciate it.
Sure, so a project I've been wanting to get off the ground, if people wanna support it, let me know, is called Game of Tones, product testing for inclusion, right? So you can do your iPhone 10, but I wanna do a Tesla. Give me a Tesla and let's do some pedestrian tracking, okay? And so let's do it not just thinking about skin tone, but how does it work if somebody's in a wheelchair? The Tesla fatality that happened was with a woman who was pushing her bike across an intersection. And so the system picked up the bike and made a prediction on the path that was different than the prediction you would have made if it was a pedestrian, leading to a fatality. If we're doing gait analysis and somebody's on crutches, right? And so the estimate for when you will turn or some of the behavioral patterns that you were mentioning also comes into play. So I am worried about self-driving cars for all sorts of reasons, but Game of Tones, product testing for inclusion. If you want it to exist, can I get a little feedback? Okay. So join the Algorithmic Justice League and we'll try to get Game of Tones like as a series on Netflix or something. Cool. We got a question over here.
Yes. Thank you for the talk. It was very inspiring. Yes. My question is, you said that the data set should be representative of the real world. Are there any standards which make sure that the data sets that get published are really representative? And this is across domains, not just in like vision or like images.
No, it's surprising. I was looking, I was like, there's gotta be a standard. Looked everywhere, there's no standard, which is part of why I'm working on the IEEE standards around facial analysis technology, and there are other IEEE standards in the P7000 group, right, that thinks about standards. Some of them are focused on robotics as well, or overall ontologies when it comes to artificial intelligence and what it looks like to verify the robustness of these systems. And it's particularly important when we're talking about data set representation to always keep in mind the population that will be targeted, right? So a data set that might work in one situation might collapse in another. So let's go back to self-driving cars. You have a self-driving car technology, it's trained in a Nordic country, they're used to caribou, you move to Australia, kangaroo come into place, the kangaroos jump, it's off the plane, so it keeps going. Kangaroo are not caribou, but that's a context collapse that's happening because of the type of data environment that you're in. So you have proposals for things like data set data sheets, similar to how you have data sheets for electronic components or nutritional labels for data, so people have a sense of the data provenance, where it's coming from, even an expiration date for the data, right? How old is it in the first place? Because right now you get data, there's nothing on it, and you just hope for the best. That's the current situation, and we need to do much better as an industry and as a field. So I'm hoping all of you can help with that.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Camille. I'm a senior at UC Berkeley. I recently did an undergraduate research project on fairness evaluation tools and how to evaluate AI bias effectively. And I'm planning to pursue a PhD in this area of algorithmic fairness. And considering that it's more of an up-and-coming field, not every school has this field established in their CS department, what tips do you have for someone pursuing a PhD in this?
I think one thing I appreciated about being at the MIT Media Lab was the freedom to explore. So even though many people were not so concerned about gender classification of darker-skinned females, though I was, right, I found it really helpful to be in an environment where people encourage exploration, and people also encourage you to go against the conventional wisdom. And now that there's more attention around issues of algorithmic bias and fairness, you're starting to see programs catch up, but there's still a little bit of lag. So when it comes to choosing research directions, sometimes you have to have the self-confidence to explore space. People support this now, right? When I first proposed, I was like, oh no, how about that other project you were working on? So sometimes you really do have to say, this is something I care about, and find a supportive environment, even if the people don't quite get what it is, knowing that they'll be there to help you is something I would keep in mind.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
Hi, I'm Santosh Lakshmi here, and thanks for the great talk. And I wish I would one day stand there and talk something like that.
You can come down, you can join me.
Okay, so my question is something on the data which you have collected and which talks about the segregation of the statistics. So my question is, does this also, or how does it include about the manual changes in the faces?
I mean, which about artificial, which one?
About the artificial changes in the faces. Does the study include that, or if I've missed anything in that perspective?
What do you mean by the artificial changes?
I mean, if somebody has changed the face artificially, I mean, those kind of aspects, does this study include that aspect as well, that vertical?
So I'm not sure if you're talking about adversarial examples where people actually perturb an image to try to confuse a neural network, because you have a lot of examples. There's a paper that just came out of Georgia Tech that is shape shifting, or mm-hmm. if you're talking about people actually trying to fool systems themselves,
right.
in their faces. Right. And so in our particular case, the images we gathered were official photos of parliamentarian members, right? So this is essentially the official headshot of a PM of some country. So we do not expect that there would be any intention to trick the systems in that way.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, thank you again for the great talk. I'm also a senior in college, and I'd love to hear what advice you have for young folks who wanna, you know, get into these areas, and as we're kind of shopping around different companies, so to speak, how we can kind of look at what these companies are doing through the critical lens of what you just outlined.
Got it. I think one thing I would say is to not stop dreaming. So I'm somebody who loves art and loves poetry, and also I love technology, and they don't have to be separate. But I found on my own journey, I felt like I had to go one way or another, or I wanted to use tech for good in some way in my earlier explorations when I was in Zambia in the UK working on sexual assault apps and things like that. I just wasn't quite sure, you know, where I would be able to find a place where it would intersect. But I didn't give up on that notion of showing compassion through computation, or understanding that the storytelling is just as important as the research that's going on. So I would say stay open to listening to what your interests are, and also not being afraid to propose new directions for the companies you end up going to, or the graduate programs you end up looking into.
Thank you.
Thank you. Over here.
Hi. Thanks for coming and sharing with us your work with us. I'm a junior at Harvard, and I was wondering if the Algorithmic Justice League is exploring how, like, current standards of classification for other other demographics as well, such as East or South Asians or people from the Middle East or Latin America, are you or anyone else working on improvements there too? 60% of the world is Asian, and I wonder if, you know, there's any thought on, like, the implications of inaccurate classification for other segments, especially in such a diverse country of immigrants as the U.S.
Oh, absolutely. So I called it a pilot parliament's benchmark for a reason. Emphasis on the pilot. I had to get my master's degree, 2 months to do the project. So I focused on that top 10 list. right? But I did definitely look at, for example, type 4 skin classification would really be a vast majority of the world, right? So not only do we not have Asia, we don't have Central America, we don't have South America, we don't have Polynesia, Micronesia, Nonesias in the data set, right? So like this is a pilot parliament's benchmark, and I did it to illustrate a point, which is we need to have continuous checks. Also, when I was looking at various Asian countries in terms of their gender parity, and I mean the US is right there, we were not even close to the top 10 in that particular demographic. So I would definitely encourage more research, and in fact, we have data set requests from all over the world, and I think our top two countries are China and India for the data that we've gathered. So I'm only expecting to see more and more research. The point of gender shades was to show that there was a lack of intersectional analysis and heavily skewed data sets. The pilot benchmark illustrates that, but it's just the beginning, and I hope more of you can help expand it out. I think back over here.
Hi, Joy. Here.
Oh, here. Sorry.
Hi. I'm Kiran. I recently finished my master's from Georgia Tech.
Woo woo! Yay, Georgia
Tech. Go Jackets! So basically, I was wondering. So you know, you said that the first step, obviously, is to understand if a bias exists in your model, right? So this might be a bit technical, but I was wondering. So say once you identify that you have a bias, what would be the next step? I mean, usually there is a lot of bad data, so how do we mitigate that once we identify that in our model there is some inherent gender bias or any sort of bias towards any particular community? What is the best way to mitigate it or reduce the amount of bias we have in our models?
Got it. So there are various bias mitigation strategies. So some of the bias mitigation strategies become at the pre-processing stage where you're actually checking the data before you're using it to train a model. Another component of it is actually during the processing part of it, and it depends on your definition for fairness, right? So if you're thinking about statistical parity, if that's how you want to define fairness, or maybe you're looking at some of the laws and you're saying we want to use disparate impact. So it truly depends on what your definition of fairness is. And then finally, you have post-processing options for bias mitigation as well. So Zemel and colleagues have done a lot of great work in terms of what bias mitigation looks like. So it truly depends on how you want to apply the techniques that are out there. But this field is also quite young and growing, so there's opportunity to think about new ideas in this area. All right, I am out of time and I'm seeing a no more questions, please. So I think it is time for me to say goodbye, but thank you all. Appreciate it. Thank you.